Hello, good morning, and welcome to our service once again here from St. Christopher's Church in Pottsriggley. Wasn't it great to hear the bells, a recording of our own church bells, but I'm afraid just a recording, how much we're looking forward to when our bell ringers can all gather in the bell tower again, and we can all gather here in church or in whatever church you would normally be in. But nevertheless, we are gathered, we are together, we are one in Christ Jesus as we come to worship him this morning. As well as being with the Lord in church, I'm also with Kim, who's just going to say hello, and just to prove that she's here.
Hello.
Thanks, love. But apart from that, we're both joined with you through the internet. We thank Andy, who's at home twiddling the knobs so that you get this live stream, and who incidentally, little known fact, was also our pianist in the music before the service. As we enter into our worship, I thought I'd just mention today that you might have noticed, if you're very observant, that most weeks I change the prayers, what we sometimes call the liturgy, the written, spoken words that we say together in the service, because just as it's not so good to have the same hymns every week, so there's such a wealth of different wonderful prayers that have been crafted and written over the years to help us when perhaps sometimes our own words run out. And that's the way in which liturgy helps us in our service and brings us together this morning. So nothing particularly unusual about today's, but once again, a different selection of prayers and of words of praise that we're going to say. And we begin by greeting one another in the Lord's name. Do join in with the words in gold, whether you're by yourself at home or with others. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouth shall proclaim your praise. May Christ the day star dawn in our hearts and triumph over the shades of night. Hear the words of St. John. This was the first sign Jesus gave, the first glimpse of his glory, and his disciples believed in him. He is Christ the Lord. Alleluia. We worship and adore him. Alleluia. And we worship God with these words taken from Psalm 100. I will be joyful in the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness and come before his presence with a song. Know that the Lord is God. It is he that has made us and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his name. For the Lord is gracious. His steadfast love is everlasting, and his faithfulness endures from generation to generation. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Well, we're now going to worship God with a song, which I invite you to sing along with at home. It's been prepared for us by some of our church members, both the instruments and the voices. And we're going to worship Jesus as we sing. Jesus shall take the highest honor.
For us.
Wonderful to hear familiar voices praising God and leading us all in offering to Jesus the honor that his name deserves. Well, he also deserves us to be honest with him as we come before him. And if we're honest, we have things that we need to say to him, including that we're sorry for when we've let him down. And that's why we have our confession now, which enables us to do it together. The grace of God has dawned upon the world through our Saviour Jesus Christ, who sacrificed himself for us to purify a people as his own. Let us confess our sins. Almighty God, long-suffering and of great goodness, I confess to you, I confess with my whole heart, my neglect and forgetfulness of your commandments, my wrongdoing, thinking and speaking, the hurts I have done to others, and the good I have left undone. O God, forgive me, for I have sinned against you, and raise me to newness of life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God, the Father of mercies, has reconciled the world to himself through the death and resurrection of his Son, Jesus Christ, not counting our trespasses against us, but sending his Holy Spirit to shed abroad his love among us. By the ministry of reconciliation entrusted by Christ to his church, receive his pardon and peace, to stand before him in his strength alone, this day and evermore. Amen. Well, we're going to hear a wonderful passage of scripture now, something from very early on in Jesus' ministry, right at the very start, really, of his ministry. And it's taken from John's Gospel, and it's going to be read to us today by Nikki.
Nikki. from the Gospel of John. The next day there was a wedding celebration in the village of Cana in Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples were also invited to the celebration. The wine supply ran out during the festivities, so Jesus' mother told him, "They have no more wine." "Dear woman, that's not our problem," Jesus replied. "My time has not yet come." But his mother told the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Standing nearby were six stone water jars used for Jewish ceremonial washing. Each could hold 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus told the servants, "Fill the jars with water." When the jars had been filled, he said, "Now dip some out and take it to the master of ceremonies." So the servants followed his instructions. When the master of ceremonies tasted the water that was now wine, not knowing where it had come from, though of course the servants knew, he called the bridegroom over. "A host always serves the best wine first," he said. "Then when everyone has had a lot to drink, he brings out the less expensive wine. But you have kept the best until now." This miraculous sign at Cana in Galilee was the first time Jesus revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thanks, Nikki. We've looked at this story together before here in St. Christopher's, and some of you might remember me bringing this in. It was a visual aid, and at the time, I apparently performed a wonderful miracle because I poured water in the top, and then with a ladle, I took out a ladle full of wine and poured it into a glass. Of course, it was all trickery, as everybody knew. Actually, talking of trickery, on a previous occasion, when I was an eager young curate, I again performed, apparently, the miracle of changing water into wine. I poured water from a carafe like this into a glass, and the water changed to deep red as it went into the glass. Actually, I'd never do that now. I shudder when I think about it. There was a few drops of colourless liquid in there, a certain chemical, and this was full of caustic soda. And I poured them in, and the two reacted, and they went red. But health and safety nightmare, which I think I wouldn't do anywhere near anyone else these days. Nevertheless, we're trying, aren't we, to get underneath that story, to get a feel of what it was like to be there, and also an understanding of what John is trying to tell us by telling us this story and describing it as Jesus' first sign, the first glimpse of his glory. There's an important word there, sign. John doesn't tend to use the word miracle, because it clearly was a miracle when Jesus turned water into wine. He uses the word sign because it's not just important in itself as a sort of impressive trick. It's important because of what it tells us. Like a sign is important not in itself, but because of where it points or what it explains to us. So what is this wonderful story of the turning of water into wine at the wedding in Galilee? What is it a sign of? What does it tell us? What does it point to? Well, the first thing it tells us is that Jesus can make the ordinary into something very special. Now, for our purposes in this story, water is ordinary. Of course, water's a wonderful thing, although we do sometimes have rather too much of it here at Posh Ridley. But water, for the purposes of the story, is ordinary, and it was ordinary water. It was some large stone water jars, and they were full of water that didn't have to be good enough to drink. It was just for washing, ceremonial washing, washing of feet and so on. And Jesus turns that water into not just wine, but the best wine. You heard that wonderful account how the steward of the feast, who is mystified by this, says, why have we kept this wine back? Why did we give them all that other stuff first? This is so much better. Jesus has turned something very ordinary into something very special. And that power to transform goes to the very heart of what Jesus is about and who he is. And so at this outset of his ministry, he's giving us a glimpse, not just of his power and his glory as God's Son, but of the way in which that power and glory is to be used. And sure enough, as the Gospels go on, we see him constantly taking people who are broken, who are unclean, who are sick in mind or body, and turning them, transforming them into somebody special, somebody who can stand in God's presence, forgiven, restored, whole and healed. He takes that which is ordinary and makes it special. But secondly, there's another aspect of the sign, and it's that Jesus does it abundantly. When you read or reread that account, you sometimes notice something that you missed the first time around, and that's the sheer quantity of water that is used. 6 stone water jars, each holding from 20 to 30 gallons. Now, this, I estimated, holds about 45 gallons. So at least probably 3 of these, and just compare that how much wine that is. Ridiculous, a ridiculous amount, far too much, but a sign because of its sheer abundance, reminding us that God is able to do, as St. Paul put it, abundantly more than we can ever ask or think. Reminding us too of what Jesus said, "I have come that you may have life and have it abundantly." That's what abundance looks like. As some of you may know, I've produced a New Year message for our church. I very much hope that you'll read it either online or ask for one of these leaflets. There's some in church, but I can post you one. But at the heart of it, there's this question about what do we do when our own resources run out? And of course, many of us are feeling at the end of our resources at the moment. And indeed, that is a feature of human life at all times, not just in a time of crisis like this. Even when we think we're doing fine, actually, we don't realize often just how thin our resources are, how quickly everything can be taken from us, how our wealth can be suddenly worth nothing, how our health can be taken from us, how our happy situation can change in all kinds of ways. It actually happens in this story. I mean, we assume that they did think they had enough wine. And one theory, actually, as to why they ran out, get this, is that the way it's written at the beginning of the passage, it looks a little bit like Jesus and his disciples sort of turned up at the last minute. Probably not all his disciples. It looks like he's got about 5 with him by this stage. But nevertheless, it seems that they may have been the cause that they ran out of wine, which is rather amusing, really. Nevertheless, for whatever reason, they thought they had plenty and it ran out. Their own resources were not enough. We are all in need of God's resources, even when we think we're not. And please do have a read of my New Year message, which really encourages us to look to God, to continue to look to God and to one another, because by ourselves, none of us have enough. One way, of course, that we draw on those resources is through prayer. Prayer for ourselves, prayer for others, prayer spending time with God. And there's a little glimpse of what prayer looks like in this story too. There's a rather strange exchange between Mary and Jesus at the beginning of the, well, not at the beginning, but before he does the, before he performs the sign. She comes to him and she says, "They have no more wine." And he gives her a rather standoffish response. It's hard to translate it exactly, but some translations make it look like he's being rather dismissive or even rude and abrupt to Mary, his mother. Whether or not he's being rude or abrupt, clearly something is going on there. And if we look closely, what is going on is that Mary comes to him with this problem. Jesus, in turn, says, "It's not exactly for you, mother, to know what I'm going to do about this. But she just then turns to the servants and said, do whatever he asks you. So she knows, Mary knows, that having brought this to Jesus, although clearly he's got his own idea about how he's going to respond and what he's going to do, it is enough for her that she leaves it with him, and he will respond in the way that is right, even if it's not what she had in mind. And that's very much what we do in prayer. We go to God and we say, we lay before him the thing that we want to bring, the person, the situation that we want to bring to him in prayer. We can't say, and this is what you must do, Lord. But we can know that whatever he will choose to do will be right, because he knows better than we do. So Jesus' abundant resources brought to us. But there's one other sign, and interestingly, this is the sign that John, and after all, he wrote this. This is the meaning of the sign that John thinks is the most important, because at the end of the passage, John writes this: this miraculous sign was the first time Jesus revealed his glory. John believes that the most important aspect of this sign is that Jesus' glory is revealed through it. Actually, if I can ask Andy to share a photo I took this morning when I went for my morning walk, a sign of God. I got a glimpse of God's glory this morning as I saw the sunrise, and inevitably you can imagine that it was even more beautiful than it looks on that photo. But we do get glimpses of God's glory if we've got the eyes to see in those things the glory of God. Well, imagine that you got this glimpse, that you were there at this wedding. And imagine that you'd seen what Jesus did, that the water went in to these jars and the wine came out, and it was good wine. You would be absolutely blown away by this vision of his glory. The interesting thing is, though, not everybody sees it and recognizes it. I suppose just as many people would have looked at that sunrise and not seen in it, as I feel I did, a glimpse of God's glory, but just a natural phenomenon. So many people were at this wedding and they didn't see the sign of glory. And I think in this case, it was because Jesus chose who was going to see it. He did it very much below the radar. And most people weren't aware of what was going on. But John tells us that it was especially for his disciples whom he was preparing, so that they could grow in their knowledge of him. And they saw what this meant. They got a glimpse of the glory of the one whom they had chosen to follow. And I think that that glory is there to be seen in all kinds of ways every day. But we need to develop the eyes to see it. We need to look at what we see around us, what is going on in our lives and in our world. We need to look at the scriptures with the eyes of faith. And then, as one or two people did on this occasion, we too will glimpse that glory. Because at the end of the day, you know, this story, it's not about us and our need, although it is in Jesus that we will find our needs met. It's not about the awkward situation that arose at a wedding. This story is about Jesus and who he is. He, John is saying, is at the center of this, and he needs to be at the center of your life too. Amen. Well, we're going to stay with that theme of wine, the wine, the new wine of the kingdom of God, in our next song. Wine in the Old Testament is often seen as a sign of God's blessing. Joel says, the mountains will drip sweet with sweet wine on the day of the Lord. Isaiah says, if you have no money, come buy wine and milk without price. It's a sign of God's blessing. And here in our story today, this wine was a sign of the one who brings his blessing. So we're going to sing about that sign now. And it's once again a song we love to sing here, actually, a song that is called One Shall Tell Another, the Wine of the Kingdom of God. So you just love that song, and believe it or not, it's a lot harder to stay together as you get faster when you're all recording in different places, but I think they did a fantastic job there. And we changed the tone a little bit now, a little bit more solemn, but incredibly important as we go to the heart of what we believe with our creed. Let us declare our faith in God. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now, led by Sandy Milson, let us pray.
As we come together in our individual homes, not just in Pottrigley and Bollington and Poynton, but around the nation and around the world, we're united as a family. So let us find a moment of peace as we lift our hearts together in prayer. Lord, we pray. We pray for the health workers tending the seriously ill, for the scientists working on vaccines, for the researchers analysing data and identifying trends, for the media outlets working to communicate reality, for the supermarket workers, cleaners, bin men, delivery drivers, firemen, police, and all the essential workers, for the good news stories of recoveries and effective planning, for the singing from the balconies, for the many, many kindnesses and community spirits, for the recognition that isolation doesn't need to mean loneliness, for the notes through letterboxes offering help and support, for the internet and telephones and technology that connects, for the awakened appreciation of what is truly important. Thanks be to God. We pray for those who are unwell and concerned for loved ones, for those who were already very anxious, for those immune suppressed or compromised, for the vulnerable, for those in care homes, and those most at risk, for those watching their entire income stream dry away, for those who have no choice but to go out to work, for those who are afraid to be at home because of domestic violence. We pray for parents juggling the demands of homeschooling and their own work. We pray for teachers working in schools and also online to keep the children educated. Lord, we pray for medical workers everywhere, restoring and healing God. Thank you for medical workers everywhere, putting the welfare of others before their own, comforting the concerned and bereaved, reassuring the anxious and vulnerable, working to heal and restore people who are ill. Be their guide, strength, wisdom, and hope. We thank you too for the research scientists who have developed vaccines and are now rolling them out. It has given us hope for the future and for a COVID-free world. We pray that the rollout will continue as efficiently as it has. Amen. A prayer in time of isolation. God of heaven and earth, in these times of isolation, apart from loved ones, distant from friends, away from neighbours, thank you that there is nothing in all creation, not even coronavirus, that is able to separate us from your love. We pray for our own church here at Pottsrigley. We ask for your blessing on Vicar David and Kim, and thank you for all the technical experts in our own congregation that ensure that we can worship as a church each Sunday morning. Amen. A prayer for the church in the world. May your love that never fails strengthen the weak and encourage the fearful. Calm the anxious, heal the sick, through your church, your washed hands and feet on earth, distant but still present, virtual but still connected, apart but still helping. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, may we bring our lives before you. May we humbly ask your forgiveness for all we have done wrong and help us to be better people, and that by the power of your Holy Spirit, you will cleanse and renew us. Amen. Lord, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Sandy. And we continue in prayer as we say, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And a prayer for this day in the church's year, this third Sunday of Epiphany. Almighty God, whose Son revealed in signs and miracles the wonder of your saving presence, renew your people with your heavenly grace, and in all our weakness, sustain us by your mighty power. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. It was lovely to be led by Sandy in our prayers. Nice to see you as well, Sandy, when we can't see one another or as much these days. It's always lovely to be reminded what each other looks like through seeing you in leading our prayers and through seeing one another in such ways. Nearly at the end of our service now, I just want to remind you, it's the same little reminder I give every week, to find ways of keeping in touch with each other. As a church family, it's so important that we do that. We've got our WhatsApp group. There'll be a Zoom for coffee together after this at 11:45. The link should be in the comments on Facebook. We pray together at 7 o'clock on a Tuesday, and if you're in the WhatsApp group, you can take part, as it were, directly in that. Otherwise, you can still join in prayer. And of course, we have these regular services for at least a little while longer. Clearly, that's going to be just online. We look forward to the day when we can meet in church once again. But still, please do keep joining in these services. And don't forget to mention it to others, especially those who haven't got the internet but might be able to watch it on a DVD. I've heard that some people find that that works quite well for them. And so please keep in touch. I like to always remind you of that. Our junior church and youth church make sure they keep in touch. Every other week, they meet on Zoom at 9:30 and 6 o'clock in the evening, respectively. I've mentioned during my talk this New Year message that I've produced for our church family, for anyone who feels themselves to be part of the church family here at Pottsringley. I do hope you'll have a read. Probably the easiest way is to go to our website, and you'll see on the front, on the homepage, there's a clear link. Look out for this logo. There it is. And that's a link to this document. But I've also done it as a little booklet, and there's as many copies as we need of these, and we do want to encourage folk to have a read. So if you'd like one of these and one hasn't made its way to you one way or another, do be in touch, and please have a look at my New Year message. One other thing as well, talking of things that are hopefully worth a read. Next week, this time next week, is the publication day of our February Hot Pot. And look, there's James plus his friend on the front cover. So watch out for that. That's always an important time for us when the new Hot Pot comes out, and we have a look what new things we can read and learn in there. Just finally, going back to the website, you'll probably notice that I circled the little link there to make an online donation, if you wish to our church. No pressure at all, but I know some people want to do that. And that's a different way of giving than if you're one of our regular givers, and that happens through standing order or whatever. But you can click on that link if you want to make a gift. So we come to our final hymn, and this one is provided for us by the wider Church of England and by some lovely singers from elsewhere. We worship God as we come to the end of our service with Alleluia, Sing to Jesus. Fantastic. And I do hope that you can hold a song of praise to God in your heart through this coming week, whatever lies ahead for you. And I do thank you too for joining me and joining one another. And I hope maybe you'll join in Zoom shortly so that you can have a bit of a chat and a catch up and keep in touch with each other. But we close with our blessing and dismissal. Christ, the Son of God, perfect in you the image of his glory and gladden your hearts with the good news of his kingdom. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord in the name of Christ. Amen.